So, Uber Eats or DoorDash or both? They both have their ups and downs. The thing I'm realizing about Uber Eats is you want to get the most, go with the more expensive restaurants like Applebee's, Ruby Tuesday's, Olive Garden, stuff like that, because the customer base that pays for the more expensive food, you know, if they're paying $80 or maybe a couple $100 for their family's worth of food, they're gonna tip you better. With Uber Eats, the reason I say that is because Uber Eats platform, the customer is allowed to take and adjust your tip up or to take your tip back for up to an hour after you deliver the food. From a customer standpoint, I could see why Uber Eats does that, but from the driver's standpoint, I kind of tend to think they should offer a base tip to begin with, and then if they want to, they can add more, and if they don't want to add more than that, then that's all the driver gets. But that driver should get what was offered to them. Like this morning, I took a $6 one and a $7 one for, I think they were 3 miles each or something like that, so the mileage made sense. But now I'm sitting on five, well, I'm sitting on $3 and $2, which is a total of $5 instead of 12. And then the tips may or may not make that better. But if both of those people decide they're not gonna tip me, I just drove what amounts to 6 miles for $5, which is not worth my time. Anything under $1 a mile, definitely not worth your time. Try to get around $2 a mile. If those tips obviously stay on where they're supposed to, at least at the $6 and the $7 range, which is about $13 or $14 I would have made for the 6 miles. I got another one here just in a sec. Nothing. I'm on both Uber Eats and DoorDash at the moment, so I'll be checking in and out occasionally as they send me stupid stuff. Notifications because I'm at work trying to do orders, but I'm doing a video in between that. And anyway, the whole point being, I would have got $14 for 6 miles, but right now I'm sitting on $5 for that same 6 miles. You know, and it doesn't make sense. Don't go to a customer for Uber Eats like McDonald's, because that's a lower. The type of people who eat or who order from McDonald's are looking for cheap food, and anybody who's looking for cheap food is going to be the type that wants to do cheap or no tips. And on DoorDash, you're okay with doing McDonald's because DoorDash does the tip up front and they can't change it. So you just take the order, what orders that make sense to you, and you take that. On Uber Eats, however, they could still give you $2 or $5 more on the tip or whatever, get their food and then turn around and take it back off. And the type of people who order McDonald's on Uber Eats, let's say, and McDonald's is only available on Uber Eats in certain markets, but let's just say, you know, some cheap restaurant like that, are the type of people who will turn around and take that tip back, or the type that are scamming you, so to speak, putting a higher tip on there so you'll go faster, you'll do their run over somebody else's. And then when you get there and you get it all done, they go back on there and they know how to cut that off. Take their tip back, they get refunded in a day, so their money is held for a day, but they get the money back, and they only had to pay for the food, just as if they went to the store themselves and got it. You know, the whole point of the whole food service tip thing is to tip your driver for their fuel and their time to get you there and back. Now that's the downside of Uber Eats, but at the same time, Uber Eats can be really good on certain stuff. Like yesterday, I did what was essentially a Walmart Spark order on Uber Eats. I went to Walmart. It said it was one package. There was like 20 bags. It's not a big deal. It's college time here. I'm in Lincoln, Nebraska, and it's the move-in week for college. So these two girls were getting a crock pot and a bunch of stuff to cook in it. They met me at the dorm and packed the bags themselves, mostly because it's a girl's dorm and I can't go in there anyway. And so I offered to try to help them to the door, but they just took the stuff themselves. But they tipped me pretty good on that. And I've had a few orders like that where, as long as it's something like a shop and go order type of deal, where like Walmart Spark, where they have groceries that they're doing, a lot of times Uber Eats customers that do that tend to not take the tip away. However, you really need to watch yourself doing Uber Eats on the, especially fast food. I would try to, unless you're bored or the it makes sense or you're ahead for that day, I would try to avoid doing fast food on Uber Eats, just for that fact. Anybody who orders fast food is most likely the type of customer that's going to try to take the tip back, because they can, because Uber Eats allows them to do that, which I, as a customer, I could see why they do it, to try to entice their customers to, you know, get on their platform and use them over DoorDash, because they allow you to base that on your food. But we ourselves, outside of using a hot bag or not, we have nothing to do with the whole food. All we do is pack the food from the store to your place. You know, the traffic conditions, the using the hot bag or not, that's the only two things that we remotely have a variable over, where we chose to drive following the map, if we knew it was busy or not, and then if we used a hot bag or not. That's the only thing that we can do to change how hot or how cold your food is. So I don't see how screwing with our tips is making a difference. But that's how Uber Eats works. You can basically, you have to wait an hour till after you deliver, like I have to do on this deal. This, what turned into $5 worth of regular base pay between two orders, and 6 miles worth between two orders, 3 miles each. That could turn into $14. That could turn into more than $14. That's a good thing. But it could just be that $5 between the two if both of them decide not to tip me either way. When the deal that I took was between $6 and $7 a run. You know, because between $6 and $7 a run for 3 miles, that's $2 a mile. That's worth it my time to do it for at least that. However, Uber Eats turns around and does that, and I don't like that idea, and I'm not ranting and raving about it, but I tend to think, and I'm letting others know, that at least in terms of when it comes to Uber Eats fast food, you want to try to avoid fast food restaurants and Uber Eats as much as you can, because those type of customers are the type that are going to take your tip, are going to con the system and take their tip back. They get their money back in a day. DoorDash, however, the mad prop about that is you can get on DoorDash and do all the fast food that you want, even McDonald's and stuff like that, because the tip is right there up front. They say this is how much you're going to get. You might get a hidden tip on top of that or not, but this is at the very least, this is what you're going to get. The downside with DoorDash is after the first 3 weeks of being a new Dasher, if you don't keep your ratings up, which I've got my ratings up pretty good, but if you don't keep your ratings up, they make you schedule all the time. That's a DoorDash buzzer now. Let's see what I've got. And then you see this. I don't know if you can see it or not. $2 for 0.7 of a mile. Honestly, that's not worth taking my time to do that, to even go across the street like that to that guy's house for $2. I mean, if you want your food, tip your people better. I'm not going to take that for $2, even though it's right across the street. That's a whole lot of time and effort, especially with McDonald's. I got to go in there and wait. And it, depending on this McDonald's, how busy, it looks like it's fairly busy over at that McDonald's. That'd be probably 5 or 6 minutes waiting at McDonald's. Then you got to cross the street and go up around the corner and deliver it to the guy's house. And if that's an apartment, then you're doing double the effort for $2 total. That's all the order is paying. Not worth my time. Not even at 0.7 a mile. Yeah, technically that's $2 a mile, so to speak. But you got to look into the effort of it. You know, for $2, is it worth my time to even do it? So you gotta set yourself a minimum, and my minimum is about $6, depending. You know, I might do $5 somewhere if it's a mile or less for $5, then it starts to be worth your time. But I would say your minimum should be around $6. Don't take any of these orders that are under $6, because you don't know how much time it's going to take you in the restaurant. You don't know how much time it's going to take you traffic-wise. You don't know, especially if it's an apartment, you don't know how much time it's going to take you and how many flights of stairs you got to go to that apartment and whatnot. It's just not worth under $6. In my opinion, there's other orders that's the other thing. You could take something under $6, and then 5 seconds later, you could have had an $8 order or higher, you know, $10 order, whatever. But you can't get it now because it went for that $6, and they gave that to somebody else. You waited. You know, and that's not a guarantee either. When you wait, you're risking the fact that you may not get a run either. But that's why you also double app. And then with DoorDash, I've noticed, and I don't know for sure on Uber Eats, I haven't done Uber Eats enough, but with DoorDash, I've noticed if you don't take the $5 underneath the $5 runs, they start to only send you $6 and above, usually. But if you change marketplaces like I have lately, because I just now gotten back into Lincoln, Nebraska, each marketplace that kind of retests the rules out again, or not the rules, but what you will, your tolerance is, I guess, what you will take again. Now, if I don't accept anything under $5, let's say, they're not going to send me anything. under $5 because they know it's a waste of their time. And once they, the algorithm sees that I've declined these three different shots, they're just not going to do it. And they're going to have to give me a better run than that. And they know that. The algorithm knows that. And then once it does do that and I take $6 for a mile and a half or whatever, then the algorithm might try to adjust that up or down and try to sneak in a lower amount here or there. And yet they pop up every now and then. But it does. It seems like on DoorDash they don't pop up the lower despicable amount of offers that are not worth your time. Don't really pop up as often on DoorDash once you've established yourself in that marketplace. So once you've been there a week, they tend to not pop up as much. Unless DoorDash is so slow that needs somebody to do it. Uber Eats, I've seen repeatedly. I've seen in Rapid City, South Dakota, $5 for 15 miles. What amounts to 15 miles, because it was 6 miles out to Box Elder from Rapid City, and 6 miles back in, so 12 miles. So let's say $5 for 12 miles worth of your time. And that's the other thing on these apps. Both these apps, DoorDash and Uber Eats, that I've done so far, and that's only two I've done so far. I'm looking into doing Grubhub and other places. But both of these apps only account for your time going from where you're at to the store to the customer. That's it. They don't count when you get out to the customer where that's at. If that's out in the middle of nowhere, then that means you're going to have to spend that amount of time and mileage back. And the easiest, fastest way to calculate if that order is worth it or not is to take what they're offering, let's say $6 for 3 miles, and double that in mileage. That very well may cost you 6 miles to get back. 3 miles out there to the customer, 3 miles back. Worst case scenario, because that puts you right back to where you were. So that's the fastest, easiest way to do your calculation when you have your 30 seconds or whatever to decide if that run is worth your time or not. $6 for 6 miles, that's a dollar round trip at the very least, you know, amount. I would at least get $1 a mile. On DoorDash, that would be worth it. On Uber Eats, because of the whole can take the tip back, and if that includes the tip and whatever, it's not the base pay, I honestly would not say it's worth it. Uber Eats, I'm going to have to put a buffer in between that, because now, especially on Uber Eats, I need to be doing, if it is fast food, I need to be doing $8 or $10 a shot for very low miles, under 4 miles, to make it worth my time. Because in the end, if they take that tip away, it's not worth my time. And then I just did all that for nothing. So to counteract that, now I've got to start deciding, remember, with Uber Eats, if I take this fast food run, if it's $8 for 4 miles, it might be worth my time, maybe. You know, because they're offering a bare minimum of $8. But the thing is, you've got to know in your marketplace where Uber Eats base pay is and whatever customer tips would be, because they don't tell you all that up front. They just say it's $8 including tip or whatever. Now, but you can do that by getting on Uber Eats and running a couple. And then after that, you know, in that marketplace, at least for that day and that week, that time, Uber Eats base pay is X amount of money. Because after you get done with an order and an hour after everything is settled, it'll show you the base pay and what the customer paid. And you can kind of go off of that, what that's going to be like that day. You know, so you can go back in there and look at what your previous order, say it was $5 base pay. That means you should be getting at least $5 minimums all day long, because that's not counting the tip. And so that same $8, you know, in the back of your head is probably, you know, at the worst case scenario, is probably $5 for whatever run that is, if they don't do a tip, because the customer can take the tip back off. So just in general, for Uber Eats, I'm going to watch what I'm doing with running fast food on Uber Eats now, because it's just not worth the risk. They start screwing with the tip like that, and the tip is what makes the difference, you know. And people get on here, they watch these videos, and they bitch and complain, but it's food service, and I've got to keep my maintenance going. I've got to keep my gas going. I've got to keep my time. Would you do $5 for the whole hour of your time? No, normal people wouldn't. You know, nowadays economy, you're trying to average at least $15 an hour, minimum. You know, I could go get a $12 an hour job at McDonald's, as far as that goes. So at the very minimum, I need to be making $12 an hour from an hour worth of my time. And then on top of that, you have your maintenance of your vehicle and gas, etc. And you've got to take that into consideration, because every mile that you go is another mile higher that your car is. Sorry about the sun at the moment. I have a sunroof right here. You can see. The sun is coming through, but I want some kind of air, but I cut the windows almost all the way up so that hopefully the audio in this video comes through. But that's what I've learned with Uber Eats and DoorDash. DoorDash, they both got their goods and bads about it. DoorDash, if it didn't do the annoying scheduling that it does right now, because every now and then you can get around to scheduling, but it's super annoying. I got another DoorDash buzzer. See what this one's about. And if it's enough, I'll cut this video off. Let's see. 5 items. Raising Cane's chicken. Red card required for Raising Cane's, which is in 4.7 miles. 5 items. It pays $8.50. It's almost twice the mileage right there. $8.50 for 4.7 miles. So at the bare minimum, you'd be getting $1 a mile either way coming back. I'm going to decline it though, because it's red card required. And it seems like a bunch of extra stuff that I just wouldn't, it's not worth my time to do it. And it's, I have noticed with DoorDash, you're better off just leaving the timer, letting it run out. Because it says you missed the delivery that way instead of declining it. I don't know how it makes a difference. They technically both count the same, but I've noticed my rating for declining doesn't go down as much if I just let the timer run out versus actually declining it. But when it comes down to it, you just gotta start cherry picking your runs, pretty much. I mean, I hate to say it, but you've gotta make, you gotta know your value and your worth and your time. At $8.50 for 4.7 miles, let's say 5 miles, just to round it up, make it easier. $8.50 for 5 miles. That's a possible 10-mile round trip. So right there, you're going underneath $1 a mile. And then $8.50, I need the red card, which I have the red card. It's just that could be a problem. Because any fast food restaurant that requires the red card, you to do the red card, would mean that most likely they're going to send you through the drive-thru or in the regular line with everybody else, and you pay for it at the register. That's the whole point of it. Other restaurants, most of the other restaurants, especially Uber Eats, is pretty good at having partners with restaurants that have shelves that you just go up there and the orders are ready to go and gone, you know. And that is one thing I will say about Uber Eats over DoorDash is Uber Eats, the majority of the time when that offer is offered to you, when you go into that restaurant, it's already ready to go. They seem to have their, for the most part, I mean, occasionally you get an oddball restaurant that doesn't have the order ready to go for some reason. Maybe they're way too busy or something. But by the time, they seem to have it down flat with the restaurants on telling Uber Eats when their order is there, whether it's available or not. DoorDash needs to stick to learn that. See, now here we go. $2 offered for 5 miles. That's a 10-mile round trip at bare minimum if you had to go out in the middle of nowhere. That's without looking at it. If you had to double your mileage, 10 miles to come back to where you're at for $2. Ain't worth my time. McDonald's for $2. It might be a hidden tip. Not worth it. Look at all the miles on that thing. And then it puts you way downtown. Oh, not way downtown, but way off in a suburb. See, yeah, I would have to spend at least a couple more miles back out of there for $2. I don't know why, right now might not be a higher peak pay for DoorDash, but $2 is like the very, very basic base pay for DoorDash with no tip. So whoever did that was no tip. You know, because at bare minimum, I think marketplace for Lincoln, Nebraska is $2 base pay, $3 peak time, and it's not peak right now, I don't think. It's, well, 10:30 is just about peak. And then whatever tips. But unless that's like a hidden tip or something, $2, that works against DoorDash to even display it as $2. Most of the time, Uber Eats is the one that's trying to lowball you with 5 or 6 miles for $2. I'm a little bit surprised that DoorDash just sent me that lowball offer. Every now and then, it comes through, and it's coming through now because I just came up to Lincoln, Nebraska yesterday, so this marketplace algorithm, and I think the algorithm's set up for each different marketplace. It's testing me out, what I will take and what I won't take, so I'm going to get a bunch of little ball offers for probably today and tomorrow. And then after that, I've noticed, at least in the other markets, that after the first couple days that you're there and you're on day three or whatever, and especially the more you're on schedule for DoorDash, they tend to start giving you better offers. And then, of course, it goes by your ranking too. By your rating, your acceptance rating, and all your customer rating and all that crap. DoorDash, like I was trying to say before that thing went through, they've got the scheduling thing. Once you get past being a new Dasher for the first 3 weeks, then you have to go off your rating as to how often you're allowed on a schedule. And the schedule is a week out, and really, you have to schedule it a week out. Like, I just now got to Lincoln, Nebraska yesterday, and I can get on for, I think it's next Thursday and Friday. Today is Saturday, and I can get on for next Thursday and Friday, I think it is, the full, not the full day, but I mean, more time slots, a week out. I have to schedule that to be able to get on, or you just kind of not schedule it and see when DoorDash will let you dash or not. Which I think is, in my opinion, stupid. That's the one thing I do like about Uber Eats more than DoorDash is Uber Eats doesn't care, doesn't have any kind of schedule or nothing. You just get right on whenever you want, get off whenever you want. Does not care. There's no such thing as having to pause orders like you do on DoorDash or nothing. If you have a DoorDash and you're on Uber Eats and you want to pause orders, you just go offline. And Uber Eats don't care how many times in a day you go offline and go online. As far as I know, they don't really give a crap either which way. It's whenever you want to do it. And as independent contractors, that's the way it should be. DoorDash is trying to do this kind of a scheduling thing to try to make you look forward to a certain time. And I could see it from a company standpoint. I could see why they're doing it, is to try to make sure they have people covering that certain time frame here or there by making you schedule it. That way you can't just hop on. That way they just don't know who's going to be on and who's not. You know, so I could see the point behind a scheduling type of thing, kind of. But I kind of tend to think we should be able to do either one that way we want. We could schedule it however many hours we want ahead of time and let them know that's what we're going to do at this time. Basically, I'm saying the schedule should be less restrictive. Right now, it's scheduled whenever they want. If they have a half an hour to cover between 12:30 and 1 o'clock tonight, that's all it says you can schedule for. The rest of the time, it locks you out. Unless it gets busy and you happen to be on DoorDash and looking, and it says it's very busy and you can dash now, then it lets you dash now. Outside of that schedule. If you're in a zone, so to speak. And that's the other thing, is chasing these stupid zones. I don't chase the zones anyway, you know. I'm just going to sit in my car and wherever I'm at and wait, because that's the more cheaper. I'm not going to say cheaper, but more effective way to do it. If you sit in a what should be a decent zone and wait for a decent order. You know, right now where I'm at right here, apparently, I thought would be pretty good. It's got McDonald's and a Runza and a couple other fast foods. It's not great. It's not the expensive restaurants, but at the same time, it's only 10:30 in the morning. So I figured, you know, breakfast time going into lunch, this might be a decent place to do it. This McDonald's looked pretty busy, and I got a couple orders from McDonald's, but they're not worth taking, and you just got to test your marketplace out. And that's basically what I'm doing right now, is just I picked the closest busy spot off of that last order it took to not have to drive clear back to where it was, and hope that I got something. And I figured if I don't get nothing, I'll just make a video about it. But hey, it's hit or miss. You know, there's things I like about Uber Eats and there's things I like about DoorDash. The biggest thing about Uber Eats that I don't like is the whole hidden tip / the customer can adjust their tip up to an hour afterward. I can see why they're doing it. It's to allow the customer a little more flexibility, I guess. You know, if they didn't like their food or whatever, they can take back some of their money and whatnot. But we're not the food service. We're not a waiter in a restaurant bringing your food and stuff. I mean, we deliver you your food, kind of like a waiter, if you want to say, but we're not a waiter that could take your food back to the kitchen and say he didn't like blah, 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 can you even make it? You know, you're supposed to have this off with that off and whatever, and they'll bring it back out to him. We're not the kind that can bring you out a dessert as a comp or anything like that. We don't do none of that as a way to make up the difference for the tip. So why are they allowing a customer to adjust the tip on us, is what my opinion is. Because as an independent contractor, I'm looking at $6 or $7 a mile, or $6 or $7 for a $3 mile run like I did this morning, and that was $2 a mile max if nothing else changes, if they don't add a tip or nothing. And then it's $1 a mile minimum if they did take their tips back. And then it, you know, to which case that kind of makes it worth it. But you got to realize in your business deals with Uber Eats that you've got to do it as that. You've got to do what it would be max, what it would be do for you minimum, and then decide if that's worth your time taking it. Because this morning, now that I know the base pay around here for Uber Eats, depending on the time of day and whatnot, is between $2.50 and $3 at a time, then I know minimum. Well, right now I think it was $5 minimum. I don't know, three and two is what I got on the last two. It, looking back at that, I kind of regret taking it this morning, knowing, or should have realized that that tip was half of the amount that they're saying, between $6 and $7. That tip is $3 or $4 of the $3 minimum that was on there, and so Uber Eats is trying to get me to do stuff for $3. And it was only 3 or 4 miles, so I didn't go too bad in the hole if they do take the tip. But I don't get how Uber Eats does that. I just, you know, they screw us over. Why would you legitimately offer somebody something for $6 or $7 or whatever, and then an hour later that could be $3? You know, that is screwing us over, in my opinion. But that's fine. I will just adjust to it, like all the other drivers should be doing. And I will no longer take that. I will do $8 or $10 at a shot, or I'm not. It's not worth my time. Minimum, you know. And if they don't want us doing that, then they shouldn't allow them to take the tip. But then I'm also going to adjust how and where I take stuff from too. I'm probably not going to take fast foods from Uber Eats unless it's very short miles, because it's not worth my time. I'm going to try to base my Uber Eats on the very more expensive restaurants, because those clientele that eat at those more expensive restaurants are liable to take and give you more of a tip on it, because they're paying more for the food, and they're the type of clientele that's not trying to screw, usually not trying to screw somebody over. The type that's going to try and do take Uber Eats for McDonald's is the type that's trying to get away with the cheapest they can be that day, $7 or $10 to eat on or whatever. They're the type of clientele that might get back on, knowing full well that Uber Eats allows you to do that, and take their couple $2 or $3 tip or whatever it was, $5 tip, back off of it. They're also the type that might put at a huge amount on an order, like $7 worth of tip on there, until they get their food and then take it right back off. Unfortunately, there are scum in this world who will do that to somebody, who will make it the order look really good, and then once they get it, they'll take it back off. And I wish, in my opinion, if they're able to take the tips off like that, we as drivers should be able to get back on there after it's all said and done, rate that customer, and tell Uber Eats we no longer want to order, and we no longer want to take a delivery from that customer. That's what should happen. If that customer won't tip or takes that tip back, that's by all means, that's their right to do that. But we as drivers should be able to get on there and rate them and tell Uber Eats that we don't want to do it anymore for that customer. And once they run out of drivers, people wouldn't do that as much then. Another order, 4.8 miles, 4.25 miles. This McDonald's. I don't know, it's a different McDonald's even. That's stupid. McDonald's out by the airport to up north. 4.25, so $4.25 for 4.8 miles, so 5 miles. Not worth my time. Drive clear out there, pick it up at that other McDonald's. Drive clear out to that suburb, end up in that suburb in the middle of nowhere. That's nowhere near fast food or nothing. You see these, you know, might have to change positions where I'm at, because it's the third time I've had to miss a delivery for DoorDash, because just where I'm at is not paying. I might have to suck it up and drive the couple miles up into more of a hot zone and count this one as a dead zone, I guess, as a probably no-fly zone type of deal. I mean, it's got four fast foods here, but so far all the offers that I'm getting are not worth it. And that's the other thing, though. I drive up to that hot zone, and now that same offer that they gave me for 4 miles, let's say it turns into 2 miles, that's because I was at the hot zone now instead of where I'm at now, which, you know, so they screw you over that way too, or they kind of can. But this video is getting pretty long. I'm just, I wanted to show you too. I switched from the Geo over to take in what I call Bauer. You know, I got two of these twins, you know, so I call Eddie and Bauer because they're Eddie Bauer branded 2003 Ford Expeditions. I'm living in this one. This is the one I fixed up all last winter. My mom has the other one that needs to be fixed up, but she's just going to be right there in the local town. Anyway, so I got to fix that car. I've got to probably sell the Geo. I don't know yet. I may or may not go back to trucking, transporting trucks later on this winter. Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. DoorDash and Uber Eats, gig work. It's great. It's nice that I can be my own boss. I can get on and off whenever I want around DoorDash and scheduling and so on. Yeah, I can come out here and do this whenever I want or not. That part I really like about it, because I'm not working for somebody else. Nobody else is my boss, so to speak. But it's got the downside too. You know, you make such a little bit amount of money here and there that it's enough to fill the food, the gas up, and then to get my food for the day. And then it seems like that's all I want to end up doing. It's the 5 or 6 runs it takes to fill the tank back up, maybe, and to do food and my insurance and phone and the stuff I have to do. But I'm not getting ahead like I used to be with transporting. But I physically, I'm feeling better. I'm doing less of a driver's foot, and then I can feel I'm losing weight. And that's the whole point of switching to DoorDash and this gig work. It's to stay local and lose a little weight. You know, because the transporting was just unhealthy. Now I have Uber Eats, $4 for 4.6 miles. So yeah, I think I'm gonna move to another zone, because this is just pathetic. This is includes expected tip. So Uber Eats could be doing $2 or $3 minimum pay with $1 or $2 tip on there, depending. And that tip, like I say, they could take that off within an hour, or they can give you more tip. It's not worth my time. If that was $8 for 4 miles, I might have been worth my time, because at bare minimum then I'd be around $3 or $4 for that, maybe. But then again, that's dependent on tips. But I did a Walmart order last night that was $8 for, I think, 4 miles, something like that average. And that paid me $26, you know, the tip. But it was 22-ish mile, or $22 tip, I think. But it was grocery run, though, too. And so Uber Eats tends to work better with the groceries and the more expensive restaurants. DoorDash tends to work probably better with the fast food, even, because of the fact that whatever you see on DoorDash is what you're going to get. That is the one thing I do like about DoorDash more than Uber Eats, is when they send you the offer, that's what you're going to get. You might get some hidden tips on top of it, but at the very least, that's what you're going to get, and it's up to you whether you want to take that for that amount. On Uber Eats, that's not what you're going to get, potentially, because they have the potential to take that tip back away. So I'm just letting you know, I mean, I like both platforms. I wish that Uber Eats didn't have the negotiation on the tips, being able to take the tips away. I like, you know, being able to add tips, obviously anybody would. And DoorDash, I wish they didn't schedule it and do this stupid week out schedule thing. I could see why they do it, but I don't like the idea. I'd rather have them be like Uber Eats, where you can just get on and off whenever you want. I mean, that's truly what we should be doing for gig work. So they've got their cons and their pros. But I'm going to move to a better zone and get this video uploaded. Like and subscribe, leave comments. Now catch you in the flip piece.